Dave, thanks for that intro and welcome everybody. We are delighted to get started with our first session here for The Ties That Bind, session one, Weaving the Fabric. I'm Kate Mylod. I'm going to be one of your moderators for this session. I'm one of our large loan originators out of our New York office, and my co-moderator is Stewart McQueen.
Yeah, thank you, Kate. Just in the interest of full disclosure, Laura Ciavera was supposed to do this, and I was her understudy, and she couldn't make it, so you have me, so apologies in advance.
So hence, we've got some scripts in front of us. We might step on each other's toes a little bit, but we'll keep it interesting. We've got three objectives for this first session. As Dave said, we're going to kind of start off with some fundamental building blocks with how we weave this fabric that is our commercial real estate industry. We are going to be looking a little bit at mezz loans, mortgage loans, co-lending situations, securitization structures, just so that we can get our baseline down. And then we're going to do a preliminary primer on what happens when we introduce a little bit of distress to each of those structures. And then if we have that distress introduced, what are some of the things that a lender should be thinking about at that point in time? So with that as our three objectives, I'll turn it over to Stewart to introduce our panelists.
Thanks, Kate. So we have three partners from Dechert on the stage here, all in our large loan origination practice. We have Sam Gilbert from Boston, Nitya, Kumar, Goyal from Philadelphia, and Greg Dolinsky from Charlotte. With that said, let's get started. Sam, we're going to start with you. It's good to see you, by the way. I'm glad you recovered from the Bruins loss. But
thank you. Thank you for getting that in early.
So let's talk about mortgage loans. Let's start with mortgage loans. 60 seconds or less. Give us what you got.
Sure. And thank you for the softball to start. So I think, you know, we have the slides up here. Everyone is probably familiar with a mortgage loan structure, either because they have one on their own house or they've worked with them. But, you know, it's the most basic sort of plain vanilla structure we have. You've got one borrower, one property, and one lender, and they've got a mortgage which secures the loan.
All right, so we'll go stick with you. You mentioned one lender. Can there be more than one lender?
Yes, there can. You know, in this example up here, we just have one lender, but you can certainly have multiple lenders, either on a pari passu basis, sort of on equal footing, or you could have an A-B note structure.
Briefly, let's go into what is a B note? Describe the B note.
So a B note, so stepping back, pari passu would be, you know, if you had two lenders coming in at 50-50, but you could have a B note structure, an A-B structure, where it's senior subordinate. So you've got the A lender, and the B note holder who is subordinate to the A. You still have the same borrower, same single property, same mortgage, not a separate loan, but you've got two lenders who are coming in at a senior subordinate.
Okay, so when you're creating the loan, what would motivate you to do an A-B structure versus just a whole loan structure?
You could have lenders who just have different risk appetites, risk profiles, right? You've got lenders who both like the property, they both like the sponsorship, but maybe one's looking for a little more yield, take on a little more risk.
So more yield, that makes me think of mezz lending. Nitya, can you give us a primer on a mezz loan? 60 seconds or less, go.
Sure. As you can see on the slide behind me, unlike an A-B structure, a mezz loan is a completely separate loan that's generally subordinate to the mortgage loan, where the mezz lender makes a loan to the equity owner of the property owner, and it's secured by a pledge instead of a mortgage. So in order to foreclose, they basically take over ownership of the property owner. And that relationship between the mortgage loan and mezz loan is governed by an intercreditor agreement.
So Nitya, why might we see a mezz loan structure as opposed to like an A-B structure? What kind of deals would have mezz loans?
I think it's similar to B note holders as well. I mean, there might be mezz lenders who are interested in taking on more risk for a higher yield. From a mortgage loan lender's perspective, lowering the mortgage loan leverage could also yield better treatment in a CMBS transaction.
Thanks.
All right, so we got a mortgage loan, we got mezz loans. A lot of complexity, potentially A-B note structures. Let's add some more complexity and let's talk about securitization. So Greg, it's your turn, you ready?
Thanks, Stuart. So as you can see over here, securitization, there's underlying commercial mortgage loans as between the loan borrower and the loan lender. And those are typically transferred to the securitization trust. So then the securitization trust will issue bonds, securities or bonds, that are sold to the investors. So the funds from the investors will flow back through the trust to the lender. And the bonds are typically, you know, tranched, they're rated. So you have the rating agencies involved that will rate that. Usually the riskier bonds will have the higher coupons, so they give you sort of more return. And then the lower, you know, the more secure ones will have a safer. And there's a master servicer that's involved that will sort of run the day-to-day.
So why do lenders turn to securitizations? Why do they use those structures?
So securitizations, they convert more illiquid assets like mortgages into tradable securities. And by doing that, it allows the lenders to either one, free up more cash to make more loans, and two, to transfer the risk associated with that sort of off their balance sheet.
Got it. So at the end of the day, who owns the loan?
At the end of the day, the securitization trust will own the loan.
So I'm going to introduce the first acronym of the day, or maybe the second one. But what is a SASB?
So SASB stands for Single Asset, Single Borrower. And so unlike sort of the pooled commercial mortgage loans that we were talking about, that one usually have one loan, usually larger, kind of like a hotel or an office building that's held by a single borrower. And so you do kind of the same securitization process, but instead of having a whole pool of loans, you just have a single one.
All right, so quick recap here. We've got mortgage loans, we can have co-lending situations, we've got mezz loans. My guess is we can probably have co-lending situations with those as well. We've got senior subordinate structures like AB notes, and then we can package them all up, stick them all in a trust together, and call it a securitization. Well, let's talk about what happens if we introduce a little bit of distress to any of these commercial real estate financing structures. Let's say that we're in our lender's shoes on, and by lender, we're speaking very generically here. Anybody who holds any kind of interest in a loan or services a loan, we're going to be referring to as a lender for purposes of this discussion. So we've got our lender's hat on, we own a piece in one of these structures that we've laid out for the fundamentals, and our borrower hits a payment default. They miss a debt service payment. If that happens, I'm thinking to myself, well, geez, I'm just going to call up my borrower and figure out what's going on, right?
No, no. You need a P&A first.
Wait, wait, wait. What's a P&A, Nitya?
It's a pre-negotiation agreement.
Okay, wait, wait. So let's see. SASBs, P&As, pre-negotiation agreement. What does that do?
So a P&A is a pre-negotiation agreement. It's a written agreement that addresses the terms of your workout negotiations, and including it says that nothing will be binding unless it's actually in a written agreement, and that the borrower is releasing lender from claims related to negotiations. It preserves the lender's enforcement rights and remedies, and also helps protect the lender against claims and defenses from any claims that might allege a breach of implied good duty of good faith and fair dealing or interference with third-party relationships.
So basically, if I'm going to kind of distill this down, what I should be thinking of as a lender here is before I reach out to my borrower to figure out what's going on, I want to make sure I protect myself. Is that right?
That's exactly right. You should always call your lawyers at the beginning of any.
So I should put a P&A in place, or actually call my lawyers just to put in a P&A in place.
Let's just unpack that a little bit. So the you're going to call the lawyers to put together a P&A. They're obviously going to take a lot of time to draft that and negotiate it.
But lawyers can't help themselves.
But you're sitting there with, you know, the borrower's missed a payment, possibly going to miss another payment. You just don't want to do nothing. What can you do?
I think I'll jump in here. I think at that point you'd want to, depending on the facts and circumstances, either send a notice of default or an ROR letter.
All right, there we go, another acronym, but what's an ROR?
So that'd be a reservation of rights letter.
What's the difference between a default notice and an ROR?
So when we talk about there's a default notice, there's an event of default notice, and an ROR letter, a lot of times they get used somewhat interchangeably, but a default notice is something you would want to send sort of either in anticipation of a potential event of default or to start the clock on an event of default, right? You may have a breach of a covenant that gives you a 30-day cure period. The borrower gets a 30-day cure period after receipt of notice. So you'd want to send the default notice there to start that time period.
I think we got a Spotify playlist going.
It's not mine. It's kind of soothing, though. I'll continue on while we figure it out. It's nice background music. It's not quite
Stewart, like, you want to check your phone? Thanks.
It's not, not like the Krefsy music. So a default notice would be if you, if something's going on, it hasn't quite ripened to an event of default, and you either want to put the borrower on notice that it's happening, or you want to start the clock. Like I said, if it's a 30-day cure period, you can send this default notice. If you get to an event of default, whether it's a missed payment, which usually will not have a cure period, you'll send an event of default notice, say, borrower, there has been an event of default. Or if you get to that 30-day time period I talked about and they haven't cured it, you can send a follow-up event of default notice. The ROR letter, reservation of rights letter, that's sort of pre-default if you have a situation where you're going to waive a requirement or you're going to give the borrower some sort of relief. You want to send a reservation of rights letter at the time that says, we're waiving this, but it doesn't mean that we're waiving future defaults. It doesn't mean we're going to waive it in the future. And I would say default notices and EOD notices usually have a reservation of rights paragraph in them. So again, the three notices sort of can be looked at. You really want to look at the facts and circumstances and see exactly what you want to say in the notice. But people do.
Well, so it sounds pretty straightforward. If there's a default, you send the default notice. Is that correct?
No, I mean, you're going to want to look at the exactly what's going on and exactly what you want to say, because you could have sort of follow-on effects from sending those notices.
And what are those?
Well, you know, it depends who the parties are. The first thing I think you want to look at is who do you need to send the notice to? Because certainly if it's the simple plain vanilla mortgage we talked about, it's the borrower you're going to send it to and maybe their counsel. If you've got a co-lender, you're going to want to send it to the co-lender. If there's a mezz lender, they will likely need a copy of it. You know, you as the lender may have your own financing in the background. You may need to send a copy to them. So this will be the first time I say it probably 100 times today is, you know, read your documents. There's likely, depending on how structured your deal is, a long list of people who need to get that notice.
And I think we'll learn in the next session what actually happens on the mezz context when you send those notices and what that triggers. But lastly, once you send the notice, can you retract it?
You could vis-a-vis the borrower, but you may not be able to. You know, it may start a chain of events with the other parties. So again, you need to be careful before you send it to sort of think out who you need to send it to and also what the effect may be. And whether you're able to pull it back. I mean, it may be as simple as, does your loan agreement say an event of default has occurred, comma, or does it say an event of default has occurred and is continuing? So read your documents again.
So it sounds, Sam, like I've got a spectrum of options here. Going back to this missed payment default, I can send a reservation of rights letter while I'm trying to figure stuff out. I can send an event of default notice letter, but I should be wary of the fact that that could set off a whole domino effect of things that maybe if I don't look at my documents carefully enough, I'm not going to be prepared for. What if I just want to go nuclear? Can I do anything if I really just want to like throw everything at the borrower?
Yes, you can accelerate the loan.
So, Greg, tell me about what acceleration means.
So an acceleration, if there's an event of default, it's when you call the entire loan due and payable at that one time. So you would have the entire outstanding principal balance, any interest, any accrued fees, things like that, they'd all be due in one lump sum payment. And you know, typically it's elective, but you know, if there's a bankruptcy, the docs usually have it be automatic.
So one of the takeaways I got from listening to Sam was when I send a notice, like an event of default notice, it's really not just between me as lender and the borrower. It sounds like there could be lots of other parties involved. Should I be looking at acceleration notices the same way?
Absolutely. I think, and again, as Sam mentioned, the theme, you know, if there's one takeaway, it's just read your documents. The more parties that are involved, the more lenders, the more complicated the structure, the more likely it is that you're going to have to send notices to multiple parties. And you want to make sure that you notify them all and you notify them properly, because a missed notice, that could be a problem.
So I can't help it but to hit the nail on the head with the theme here. We've got lots of different ties that bind, it sounds like. All right, so let's say that it's been a month. We've put the pre-negotiation agreement in place with our borrower. We actually decided to send a reservation of rights letter. We're talking to the borrower next week. We're trying to get a handle on what the status of the loan is. At this point, what strategies should I, again, with my lender hat on, be thinking about before I talk to the borrower? Greg, you told me about acceleration. That seems way too aggressive at this point. Do I have to actually accelerate and take steps to enforce the loan?
No, you can choose to waive the default.
So what, in this context here, where I've got a missed payment and a payment default, what kinds of things should I be thinking about waiving?
So you can elect to waive the late fees, and if they end up making the payment, you can waive the sort of the default interest.
So I could decide just to waive the payment altogether, or what I like to call the gravy, right? Like the late fees and default stuff.
That's right.
So interesting. And again, going back to like all the different parties at the table here, if it's just between me as lender and my borrower, can I just make that unilateral decision to waive the default?
Again, no. I mean, if you have the very basic mortgage loan structure that we started with, if it's just you, a lender, and the borrower, it's probably just you're the one making the decision. But the more people, the more complicated, the more parties you have to go to get the permission to do that.
So let's say I've lined up consensus with everybody and we're like, all right, we're thinking about doing a waiver here. You know, candidly, nobody really likes to carry some defaulted debt on their books. But what are some pros and cons that I should be thinking about, right? I might call up, you know, I've got to go to my investment committee. I've got to talk to people, figure out what my argument's going to be. What are the pros and cons of granting the borrower some kind of waiver in this circumstance?
So if you grant a waiver, it's cheaper. It's a cheaper option, right? You don't have to go through the litigation process. As a lender, you might not actually want to own the property, which is important, right? You might not want to do the foreclosure. And if it's a more minor default that's curable, you might be able to keep your income, your revenue stream, so it might not need that nuclear option of taking it that far.
So I guess what I'm hearing here is it can really be shades of gray, right, with any given situation with the borrower dealing with some distress. It sounds like in addition to there being lots of other people at the table with me, there might be lots of different motivations and limitations that are impacting what I as lender want or want to do, or maybe what my borrower can do. Stewart, what do you think?
To borrow your terminology, the gravy, I'm okay waiving that, you know, getting rid of the default interest or late fees, but I don't want to give the payment default away. You know, we know that the borrower is likely to continue to have more problems down the road. I don't want to take the property. I'm not in the business of managing property. What else can we do?
So I think here you've sort of moved from waiving something temporary to a more permanent sort of modification situation, right? Again, you don't want to own the property, but you're not going to just keep waiving things. So you'd want to talk to the borrower after you've got the PNA signed and work out, you know, some sort of modification that's going to fix the problem, hopefully, down the road. Keep the loan going. You know, we've put some common modifications up here, things that are not just waiving, you know, a missed payment, but actually sort of fixing the loan, resizing the loan, changing maybe some of the debt yield or DSCR tests, but doing something that's more permanent than just a temporary fix, temporary waiver, but not quite there to enforcing and foreclosing.
Got it. So I hear we have waivers, we have just take the property, cut the borrower out of it, or some kind of permanent fix with the modification. Is there anything else?
Yeah, you could, instead of a permanent modification, you could pursue a forbearance agreement.
How does that work?
Well, a forbearance agreement, at that point, there's usually an acknowledgement that a default has occurred. So it's more of a temporary fix where the lender agrees to stand down or forbear from pursuing its remedies for a period of time in the short term to allow the borrower to maybe do something at the property level to help fix the issue. And in exchange, the borrower usually releases its claims and defenses against the lender, and the lender is still preserving its rights and remedies going forward.
So what would an example of a forbearance look like in the context of where you have a property that has some income coming off of it, but not enough to cover the debt?
Yeah, so I mean, it definitely depends on the circumstances of the situation, but it might just be that the borrower needs a period of time to lease up significant vacant space. So you might let the debt service accrue for 6 months to allow them to get a new tenant in and for that tenant to start paying rent. And then when that holiday is over, then there's a certain period of time to make up those debt service payments, and including their regularly scheduled debt service payments.
Forbearance sounds awfully familiar. Have we used that lately or recently?
Yes, we did use it a lot during COVID. A lot of people in those first few months used forbearance agreements for a quarter or two.
All right, so now we have that agreement in place. We've gone through all our options. What happens if the borrower doesn't fulfill its obligations under the forbearance agreement?
Well, then all bets are off.
So wait a minute. So you set up this forbearance arrangement to kind of be like a fixed, as soon as the borrower missteps, all bets are off? Yeah?
Yeah. Yes.
But that's draconian, right? Like, what might happen after that?
Well, at that point, you consider moving forward with remedies.
All right. So let me just recap the example that we've been parsing out here, right? We've got a payment default. We put a pre-negotiation agreement in place. Like, there's a lot of steps here, right? Payment default, pre-negotiation agreement in place, reservation of rights letter, event of default letter, another payment default. Maybe there's another payment default. We don't want to go down the loan mod route. We try the forbearance route. Borrower isn't able to hold up its end of the bargain. Things are obviously not looking really good. And now maybe we do need to start thinking about enforcement is what I'm hearing from Greg. So I know in session three later today, we're going to address specifically some of the different enforcement options that a lender can be thinking of. But Greg, what should I, with my lender hat on now, start to be getting my brain wrapped around?
So you can break remedies down into some sort of basic categories. So there's, you know, receivership. There's starting a foreclosure, there's pursuing guarantee claims, and there's also self-help things like applying funds to the debt or you know, utilizing cash traps.
So that's a lot of options. I mean, would I just try everything with my borrower? Would I throw the book at them and say, hey, if one is good, 10 is better?
No, you definitely don't want to do that. So first you need to sort of decide what you want to do, what steps you want to take. Do you want to own the property or not? Is there a guarantor that you can go after? So you kind of want to think about that internally, and that's usually when you call one of us to talk it through.
All right, and so same question that we've asked before. Can the lender make the unilateral decision to enforce?
And same answer, got to read your loan documents, got to know the structure, got to see who's involved. The more parties that are involved, the more likely you need to get consent from other people.
So, and because we've been saying that phrase a lot, and again, I don't think it hurts to kind of hit home on what that means when we talk about the people with seats at the table, or can we unilaterally take some action. If I'm a mortgage lender, and it's me and my borrower, and I hold on books, then I probably don't have to talk to a lot of other people, right? Am I getting that straight? Okay. But let's say I'm in a co-lending situation, and there's three people who share in the mortgage loan with me. I'm probably going to have to talk to them about what I do next, right? Okay, and if I'm a mezz lender, then I bet I know where this is going. I probably have to talk to the mortgage lender about certain things. Okay, and then if I'm in a securitization trust, I know that there was a slide up there a little while ago that had lots of boxes and arrows and party names on it, and my guess is I probably have to talk to all those people too.
Yeah, the general rule of thumb, the more complicated the structure, the more cooks in the kitchen, the more parties involved, generally the more consents you'll have to get.
Okay. So again, I bet I know the answer to this question. Will enforcement be quick and painless?
No, unfortunately not. It's usually local law specific, so that throws up some roadblocks, and then, you know, the borrower or other interested parties might try to get in the way and slow down the process.
Okay, so it's
wait a minute. So you're talking about mortgage loans, right? Like foreclosing or mortgage loans aren't quick,
yep.
But isn't a mezz loan foreclosure very fast?
It's certainly quicker than a mortgage loan process, but you still, you know, it's never a guarantee.
Does it depend on where jurisdiction you're in?
Yes.
Okay. So let's say we've gone gangbusters. This payment default example that we've been parsing out, has snowballed, right? We're now 6-9 months into this. We've had to take some action. We've lined up all the requisite consents we need from all the parties. And something miraculous happens. The market turns, the borrower gets an infusion of equity, they put a modification workout proposal on the table in front of me. I'm halfway through my enforcement process. Am I stuck? Do I have to like finish what I started, Greg?
No, you can cease the process and work with the borrower.
Okay, so I guess maybe if I'm taking away a few things from this, in addition to making sure I read my loan documents so I know who all the people are at the table, and not acting unilaterally when I have to get other people's consent, is that nothing can't be further modified with a borrower if the tides turn, right? I heard that we can pull back notices if we need to, although there might be some lasting ripple effects if we do that. But certainly if we're trying to work something out with a borrower and it's going in one direction, but there's something fortuitous that sends it into another direction, you're saying the horse hasn't always left the barn.
Yeah, you can stop the process. You can sit down with the borrower, you can work things out, and you can kind of move it in a different direction if you want to.
Okay, well, that's great.
Well, that concludes our first session. Thank you all for taking the time. You know, it was a very basic session, but we wanted to build the building blocks of the kind of the mortgage loan structures, all the various parties that have to be involved. We also wanted to kind of give like some of the initial steps that need to be taken when you're in a workout situation or default scenario, and then some potential strategies. In the next couple sessions, we're actually going to present a very detailed fact pattern and try to, you know, at least session two, we're going to look at it from the perspective of through the lens of a mortgage lender, how they will view that specific fact pattern. Then we'll look at it through the lenz of a mezz lender, how the mezz lenders would think about it. And then finally, we'll conclude with, if the loan's securitized, we'll think about how the various parties to the securitization trust will view that particular fact pattern.
That's great. So we have a little bit of extra time, miraculously, on the clock. Any questions from anybody?
I'll come down. Always wanted to be thought on of you.
Appreciate it. Thank you. This may be something you'll get to later, but as Stewart made a comment earlier, hey, we're a lender. We're not in the business of operating real estate. I know we've got some friends in the room who are closely affiliated with folks who do operate real estate, right? Especially with the proliferation of debt funds and non-bank lenders. Curious, just anecdotally, what are those, is there any kind of perspective you all could share around conversations you may be having with folks who, you know, unlike banks, may be less hesitant to take back a property if it comes down to it?
But.
There are definitely pirates in the room, so.
Yeah. I was going to start off by saying I'm going to give a very lawyerly type answer, right? Which is people can find opportunity anywhere, right? And I don't think that's any different than, you know, kind of at any other place where we are in the cycle in the market.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I think especially shops that operate on the equity and the debt side, they look at opportunities. They, you know, not only about just taking the property away from the borrower, but also coming in from the borrower side and working with the borrower to try to infuse more capital into the structures. So we've seen all those conversations recently.
Yeah. Okay. Then with that, thank you, Greg and Nitya and Sam, for getting us started with the first session. I understand the three of you will be floating around throughout the afternoon for questions if people have it. That's great.
We'll be back up here too.
And I think we're seeing you again, Sam, right? Great. All right. So with that, we'll wrap up our first session and we'll take a couple minutes to shift our panelists and we'll be right back.